Austin, Texas, capital city of the Lone Star State and home of the University of Texas. And this month, Austin becomes the mecca for women's basketball, where the competition has never been better thanks to improving talent and several rule changes. Our Frank Lieber has a look at the state of the art in the women's game.
While the 64 men's teams chosen today by the tournament selection committee try to stay on the straight and narrow road to Lexington, Kentucky, 32 women's teams are setting their sights on the capital of the Lone Star State, Austin, Texas. And it'll be in this arena, the Frank Irwin Special Event Center, more affectionately known to those in this part of the country as the Superdrum, for rather obvious reasons, that the four survivors will gather for the semifinals on Friday, March 29th, and the final game on Sunday afternoon, March 31st. And one of those final four may very well be the tenant of the Superdrum.
Now, number one ranking is nothing new in the Texas campus if you're talking about UT football, but women's basketball, well, that's something else. The Lady Longhorns have been at the top of the polls most of the season. Led by sophomore Andrea Lloyd and junior Fran Harris, they couldn't be more pleased that the Final Four is going to be in their own backyard.
Having the Final Four here is definitely an incentive for us to play well and to eventually make it back here. I think that's motivation enough for us to just go and really play tough defense and really execute well on offense. And I think it's in the back of everyone's minds. We just want to get back and play on our own home court.
Texas coach Jody Conrad brushes off those who would compare the women's game with the men's game.
We think it's an exciting game, and we don't want to be compared to the men anymore. We want to be appreciated for what we do, which is, I think, play a great brand of basketball.
Now, there is a young lady who doesn't mind at all having her basketball skills compared to the guys. Cheryl Miller of USC came out of high school touted as the best ever, and who's to argue? In her first 2 years, the charismatic Cheryl led the women of Troy to back-to-back national titles, and last summer paced the U.S. Olympic team to a gold medal performance. Now, things have changed. This year, it's been a lot rougher for Cheryl. A lot of double and triple teaming. Her coach, Linda Sharp, knew it was coming.
She's scoring more and she's getting more rebounds because we just don't have that other frontline player on this team. And it's a tough position that she's in.
The missing ingredient this year, the graduated McGee twins, Pam and Paula.
There's a lot of added responsibility on my part now. I know I have to go out and rebound a certain amount of boards. I know I have to go out and score a certain amount. And that puts a little pressure on myself, but it's helped me to rise to the occasion, and it's made me a stronger player.
No question that Cheryl Miller is exciting to watch, but someone decided that there aren't enough Cheryl Millers around. So the Women's Rules Committee in the offseason decided to make the women's basketball slightly smaller than the men's basketball.
The ball was intended to make the game more exciting for women. You know, we hope that going to a smaller basketball would speed up the play by decreasing turnovers, by increasing shooting range, by maybe making ball handling a little crisper, and then there was always the possibility of the dunk.
And it was inevitable. The first recorded dunk in women's competition credited to Georgianne Wells of West Virginia against Xavier last December. It was a moment she'll never forget.
A lot of girls are seeing me slam or heard of me slamming, and I think that a lot of girls are going to look up to the first woman who did slam.
Iowa coach Vivian Stringer wrote an open letter to her team's fans urging them to help break the all-time women's attendance record of 10,622. To her utter astonishment, over 22,000 fans showed up for the game against Ohio State.
I couldn't believe everything seemed so quiet, and when we came out there, it just brought tears in my eyes to believe that so many people honestly would come for, you know, our basketball game here.
Like the men, the ultimate goal of every women's college basketball team is the championship trophy. The last two trophies rest in Heritage Hall on the campus of USC. But with the Final Four in Austin this year, the team to beat may very well be the Lady Longhorns of the University of Texas.
And which 32 teams will begin the road to Austin? Well, we're going to have those answers for you, and we join Gary Bender live in Kansas City following this word from your local stations.
He's a new private eye who's in just a little over his head.
Pass me the Mr. Magnifying Glass and the magic pencil, please.
Jed Hirsch is the detective in the house starting Friday, March 15th.
This is CBS.
It's Academy's pre-inventory sale. We would rather count money, not merchandise, and give our customers the benefits. Choose from 5,000 pairs of jelly shoes, only $1.88, or the biggest assortment of tents, three-man dome tent, only $38.88. And choose from 3,000 wooden camp stools, only $2.44. Also choose from 2,000 white canvas folding cots, only $16.66. Or 1,000 dining canopies, only $16.66. Academy, the most interesting stores, four big stores to serve you, open all day Sunday.
I'm Pat Sajak.
And I'm Vanna White. Join us for Wheel of Fortune.
Catch the phrase that pays with America's favorite half hour of fun. Wheel of Fortune, where the pace is fast and the stakes are high.
Don't miss it, because we're making dreams come true.
Wheel of Fortune, weeknights at 6:30 on Channel 7. This is KTBC-TV, Channel 7, Austin.
Hi, everybody. I'm Gary Bender, and we're set to announce the 1985 tournament field for the women's competition. And alongside me to assist me in this announcement is the Assistant Athletic Director of North Carolina State, Nora Lynn Finch, who is also the chairperson for the Women's Selection Committee. And Nora Lynn, this year you've done something a little bit different. You've gone from 4 seeds to 8 seeds.
Yes, we have, Gary, and I think by doing that we are protecting our national seeds a little bit. We're spreading out our quality and we're projecting some great regional matchups. I think as you'll look around, you'll see we have 8 great seeds.
Well, to show what you're talking about, the number 2 seed, ODU, has beaten the number 1 seed, Texas.
Well, gosh, if we went down the bracket, we'd find that each has beaten each. It just seems like Long Beach has beaten Louisiana Tech, and then Old Dominion has lost to Louisiana Tech. It just goes on and on. This championship is up for grabs.
Okay, let's go now to the pairings board, and we'll go by the 4 regions. Let's start now with the West region. Now, one thing I want to ask you, Nora Lynn, before we get started, why the differences on the days that they're playing the games?
Well, Gary, we're going to take our first round games to the home courts of the higher seeded teams, and some days are simply better for some to host. As you go through this bracket, we're going to see some names that will crop up on the men's NCAA tournament bracket, and obviously we don't want to go head-to-head with those games.
We should also indicate as we go through the boards that the bottom team on each bracket will be the home site. Now, in the West region, the number 4 seed overall is Long Beach State, and the number 5 seed is Georgia. Here's the way they'll go. On Saturday, Brigham Young will play at Long Beach State. On Friday, Idaho will be at the University of Southern California. Also on Friday, UCLA will be at the University of Washington, and on Saturday, Tennessee Tech will be at Georgia. Now, Tennessee Tech and Georgia, you had to send them west.
Yes, we did. That is a reflection of our national seeding. We have taken Georgia as a national seed out of their natural region, and for a first-round matchup, we've taken another just natural close rival. That's going to be a good game.
Okay, let's go on now to the next region. This region is the Midwest region, and the number 3 seed overall, Louisiana Tech, is in this region, along with the number 6 seed, Northeast Louisiana. On Friday, Illinois State will play at Louisiana Tech. Also on Friday, San Diego State is at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. On Saturday, Memphis State at Auburn. On Thursday, Missouri will play at Northeast Louisiana. And Nora Lynn, there's a tremendous matchup, a possibility between Louisiana Tech and Northeast Louisiana.
Well, Gary, I'll say fireworks are going to be down in Monroe, Louisiana. Already that regional tournament has sold out. If Louisiana Tech and Northeast Louisiana win their games and get to the finals, we're going to have 2 teams that have played twice, each has won a game. Oh, my goodness, those Louisiana folks are going to have a ball down there.
You have to speak Cajun to go to that game.
You have to scream Cajun to go to that game.
Okay. Let's go on now to the next region. This is the Mideast region. The number 1 seed overall, Texas, is in this region. By the way, that's where the Final Four will be this year, is in Austin. And the number 8 seed is Mississippi. On Thursday, Western Michigan will play at Texas. On Sunday, Middle Tennessee State at Western Kentucky. On Saturday, Virginia's at Tennessee. And on Friday, Southern Mississippi is at Mississippi. And boy, those 2 schools are not far apart either.
No, Gary, and they've not played during the regular year. So we're going to take a couple of teams that are natural rivals in their own states, put them together, and I think we're going to have a great game down in Mississippi. And then Western Kentucky, hosting the Mideast Regional, may be playing Texas on its home court. And I really think we're going to have a great matchup if those teams meet, too.
Okay, let's go on now to the last region, the East region. The number 2 seed is Old Dominion, and the number 7 seed is Ohio State. On Saturday, Syracuse plays at Old DU. On Friday, St. Joseph's at North Carolina State. On Sunday, North Carolina at Penn State. And then also on Sunday, Holy Cross at Ohio State. What do you expect to come out of this?
Well, if the seeds win, and that's a big if, because these are great matchups, too. If the seeds win, we see the potential of some rematches. We have the chance for Penn State to avenge an earlier loss to Ohio State, and an opportunity for Old Dominion to avenge an earlier loss to NC State. And any time you have those kinds of matchups, you have great games.
What's been the most difficult thing about this selection process?
Oh, Gary, choosing the final at-large teams has been so hard. It's a 32-team bracket, and there are only 15 at-large berths, and there are so many good teams, more than 15, and that has really been tough.
I've enjoyed it.
Gary, you're great.
Thank you. Okay, we'll go back to New York, reminding you, though, that the championship game will be on CBS. That's on the 31st in Austin, Texas. Back to you, Brent.
Hi, Gary. Thank you. And we continue. The road to Lexington heads south, deep south, for a look at the player they call the...